to the world the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven, nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ. While fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy.
Well, welcome tonight. Good to have you all here. Well, God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Amen. So, and I usually say good morning, church. Well, we're here tonight to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ and to sing and to celebrate and just for the joy. And, you know, as I see people putting up Christmas trees, like at work, and I often wonder, do they know what they're doing when they're putting up a Christmas tree or what they're celebrating? And I'm going to start asking them. Say, do you know why we celebrate Christmas? You know, why do we celebrate the birth of Christ? And of course, the reason is he was born so that, you know, 33 years later, he would die for us so that we would have a relationship with God once again. You know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whoever should believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life. And we believe that here with all our hearts, that he died for us and he lived for us. So let's pray. Father, we give this service to you tonight as we sing glorious praises to you and we lift you up. And we're going to read your word and we thank you for the scriptures that you have given us. And we just give it all to you in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're looking forward to hearing these folks lead us in worship tonight. Amber, you going to introduce everybody?
Yes. So I'm Amber, for those who don't know.
I'm Isla.
Kylie.
Elise.
That's Elise, if you didn't hear. And that's Mason.
That's Mason. All right, you want to stand? We're going to worship God.
Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come. The little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes. But little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay. Close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care, and fit us for heaven to live with thee there. To the world the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven, heaven, nature sing. Joy to the earth. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. No more let sin and sorrows grow, no thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow, for as the curse is found, for as the curse is found, for as the curse is found. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love. Let's sing joy to the world. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven, heaven, nature sing.
All right, thank you. Well, next we're going to, this is a tradition here. We're going to be singing, I'm not going to be singing, but Diane, Amber, Emily, and John, Alan's going to be on the piano. We're going to sing O Holy Night.
Praise His holy name.
praise his name forever, aren't we? Amen. Brian? Out of here for you. And Brian's going to read this, and then Adam's going to come up and share the word with us.
You get to follow me, Adam. It's 5 to 10, right?
Yes. 1 John 5, 5 to 10. Who is he who oversees the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not only by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witnesses on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree as one. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater, for this is the witness of God, which he has testified of his Son. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God that has given of his Son. Adam.
I may have miscommunicated. I wanted 1 John 1, 5 to 10, not 1 John 5, 5 to 10. So let me read this passage because it ties into what I'm actually going to speak. That's a great passage, Brian. That's not the one I wanted read, though. So this is 1 John 1, verses 5 to 10. This is the message we had heard from him and declared to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. So in this passage, the Apostle John, who wrote this book of the Bible, is telling us that God is the light of the world. And there are multiple passages in the New Testament where Jesus talks about this analogy between light and darkness. So you're either with Jesus in the light or you're in the darkness. A few weeks ago, for those of you that were here for our Rest of the Story miniseries, we looked at John chapter 3 the one week during that miniseries, and you may remember the final three verses of John chapter 3 that we had looked at, which is verses 19 through 21 of John 3. It says this. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be plainly, or that it may be seen plainly, that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. So if you love Jesus, you are in the light. But if you reject Jesus, reject his morals, cling to the ways of the world, then you are in darkness. Later in John, Jesus calls himself the light. This is John 8:12. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will walk in darkness. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So when we are in the light, it means we are living with God. Without him, we are in darkness. Now, technically speaking, scientifically, darkness doesn't exist. It's just the absence of light. It's not a measurable thing. We can measure how much light there is, not how much darkness there is. So you either have light or you don't. Now, I had an opportunity to visit a place called the Lost Sea, which is in Tennessee. It's an underground lake. It's really cool. You hike down through this cave to get there. And there's one area where you come to this really big room in this cave, and they turn off all of the lights in this cave, and you are far enough from the entrance, no natural light gets down there. So it is total darkness. And it's really eerie to be in that total darkness. And I remember the last time we were there, standing there. I mean, they don't leave you in darkness too long. But just thinking, you know, this is what hell's going to be like. Because we know God is light, and in hell you are separated from God. So while we may picture hell with, you know, lit up by fires and this and that, and every, you know, whenever you see pictures, you see Satan surrounded by fires lighting it up. I actually believe hell is going to be complete and utter darkness. Because God is light and hell is completely separated from the darkness. And there are a few verses that back up what I have to say. For example, Matthew 8:12, when we have the story of the faith of the centurion, we get this comment from Jesus. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now, weeping and gnashing of teeth is a phrase Jesus used a lot when describing hell. For example, he uses this again, telling the parable of the wedding banquet in Matthew 22, when he says this in 22:13. Then the king told the attendants, tie him hand and foot, and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So here's another fact about light and darkness. You can only have one. There's either some light or there's not. There's not, you can't have both. If I had John turn every light in this church out, we still wouldn't have total darkness because there would be a little natural light coming in through the window. When you're a follower of Jesus, you're either a follower or you're not. There's no middle ground. You can't deny Jesus and follow Jesus. It's one or the other. You're either headed to an eternity in the light in heaven with Jesus or to the darkness of hell. Now, none of us are perfect. We've all sinned in the past. In fact, I'm willing to bet most of us, if not all of us, have sinned at some point today. I know every time the Eagles turn the ball over, I sinned. But a win is a win, right? But Jesus could still use us. We could still be followers of Jesus, even though we're not perfect. It says this in 2 Corinthians 4, chapter 6. For God who said, let light shine out of darkness, made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. Now, let light shine out of darkness has a double meaning here. It references back to creation when God created the light out of the darkness. It's also how he can create the light of the Lord in us despite the darkness of our sin that is already in us. When we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, God creates this light in our heart, and it's through that light we are called to take that out into the world. Now, I want you all to imagine that if this church was full of everybody in the world, and those that you knew, your family, close friends, were in your immediate area, and as you got farther away, you'd have your community, and as we got farther and farther away, the rest of the world that you're not necessarily connected with. So those on the other side of the world would be probably on this half of the room, since you're all on that half, which is perfect symbolically because we have the map of the other side of the world here. If you have the light of Jesus in you, it's going to shine to those in your proximity. Your light is not going to reach the people on the other side of the world. You're not necessarily responsible for that. Now, the church, and not just this church, but the church as a whole, we send missionaries to the other side of the world to reach that. So through us, our light can be in China or India or Africa through the proxy of the missionaries that we are sending overseas. But what is your light doing to those that are in proximity to you? Your candlelight, so to speak, is only going to extend but so far. So that's your area of influence. Are those in your area of influence seeing the light of God in your words and deeds? The stronger your relationship with God, that brighter that light is going to be. The brighter the light, the bigger the influence you're going to have on some people. So is your light the little candle? Or is it that? This is going to have a much bigger influence than the little candle. The stronger your relationship with God, the brighter your light is going to be. for those around you. Here's another scientific fact about light. It's completely silent. So if somebody knows who you are, if they are in your sphere of influence, they shouldn't be shocked to find out you're a Christian. They should be able to tell by your light that, oh, that makes sense. Now I understand why you're a little bit different. If I put a filter on these lights, like we have the red and the green back here, you can tell, oh, those lights are a little different. They're a different color. Do those in your area of light know that your light shines a little different? It shines different than our culture, our world, that tells us there's no morals, you can do whatever you want, be whatever you want. That's not how God told us to live. So is your light showing the message that you want it to those around you? Or is it standing out against our culture of sin? Diane, Emily, and John just did a wonderful job singing O Holy Night. If you remember the one line from verse 1, long lay the world in sin and e'er pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. This world is full of darkness and sin. It's up to us to be the light of Jesus in that world of sin. In a minute, we're going to sing Silent Night. The third verse begins, Silent Night, Holy Night, Son of God, loves pure light. What started as Jesus coming down to earth to be the light of the world is now our responsibility. Jesus was the light of the world, and he came down here next week as we celebrate Christmas to celebrate his arrival. It's now our job to carry forth that mission and be the light of the world, to show the love of God to the world of darkness and be a beacon of Christ's love in this world around us. Les is going to come up here and read 1 Thessalonians 5, 4 to 10, I hope. Yeah. Which affirms our need to be different from how our culture, to be different from our culture and to be the shining light for God. So as you listen to Les reading this passage, notice how we are called to be the light and not the darkness of the world. Especially the last two verses he's going to read, where we are reminded that Jesus came and died for us, so that we can live with the light of the Lord. Hopefully your light is shining brightly for Jesus this holiday season and all year long. Les?
Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of the light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for the helmet of hope of salvation, for God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him.
Sing that one more time.
Father, we thank you for all that you've done for us. Lord, I just think how you've changed my life and many, many lives in here. Because of your birth and your death, you've shown us the light, that light that burns brightly in each one of us. And we're so thankful for that, Lord. And I'd like to close with this scripture. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. And you're all welcome to stay. We have some refreshments, some coffee and cocoa or whatever back there. So blow out your candles and fellowship. And just a reminder, I had mentioned this morning, but next Sunday,